The following Truth Barista podcast is a High B Ministry production. Hi, this is Pastor Jay Christensen. I am the Truth Barista, and I just want to have a little word to our listeners today. As you know, this is a podcast, and it's set in the imaginary coffee shop called the Ersatz Coffee Shop, which is a word that means fake. And we just try to set up the scenario for the fun of creating theater in the mind. But it is a podcast that we hope goes across the world and speaks to many, many people. And you know, if you are excited about this podcast, we would really like to hear from you. So send us an email with your questions, suggestions, and comments to thetruthbarista@gmail.com. And you can rewind this and get that again, thetruthbarista@gmail.com. You can go to truthbarista.com, or you can go to High Beam Ministry, all one word, highbeamministry.com, to get recent updates, episodes, writings, resources, all sorts of stuff. Now, we'd like you to join Amazing Larry, who is my imaginary kitchen help, and
that's
myself. And we're going to continue our study in eschatology, end times things, markers and signs. You ready to go? And here we are.
It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it. It's the end of the world as we know it. And I feel fine.
Everyone was warned, but no one listened. A rise in temperature, ocean patterns changed, and ice caps melted. They called it extreme weather. They didn't know what extreme was. Hurricanes, tornadoes, floods, and droughts unleashed a wave of destruction upon our planet.
Welcome to the Ersatz Coffee Shop. This is Jay, your Truth Barista, and I'm serving up a steamy cup of God's truth for the average Joe. You can catch me and this podcast on my websites, truthbarista.com, all one word, truthbarista.com, and highbeamministry.com. That's H-I-G-H-B-E-A-M ministry.com, as in car high beam. We're shining the light of God's truth on the road ahead.
Truth Barista, once again, we're actually going to sit down and study the Bible.
Yeah, I know. Friday.
Hey, you know something?
Yes.
This new normal is really nuts. Everybody's talking about a new normal.
I think we may very well become a culture that, at least in the wintertime, when there are so many respiratory viruses circulating, that we'll be more like Asian cultures, where they more readily wear masks.
But I think, from what I gather from your notes you've given to me, you're going to talk about a new normal, but it's a new normal according to Bible prophecy.
I know. It's really interesting to me that you get various time periods where we always think things are going to go along as normal, and then all of a sudden something switches and you go, things are not going to be the same again. And the Bible actually talks about a time period that is not ever going to be normal again. We will be transitioning into a new normal.
Well, you know, I am amazed at how quickly everything has changed, Truth Barista. Think of all the way we educate our children now. We hold business meetings and church meetings and all of that by technology. I mean, that is just kind of came that quick.
You want to talk about a new normal? I mean, I've been just swimming in the news this week and actually getting kind of depressed about it, actually. But what was fascinating to me is they're saying with all the at-home homeschooling, it's put a lot of stress on families and parents, etc., and being out of work. But it has also shown families that they can study online, so why pay tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of dollars to universities to support buildings and massive staff bloat and all this stuff when you can get this type of information at home? And suddenly online education is going to become, I believe, a new norm.
And the education that we get from the internet will be controlled by someone.
Well, that's the other case.
And that's a little scary.
I saw a news report where a professor at Harvard has said we can't allow people to homeschool
because
there's too much parental indoctrination. parental indoctrination as opposed to professional education indoctrination. So, boy, is that ever showing her colors, right?
Right, absolutely.
Well, that also led me to something else. I found another news article that said there is a new norm coming to the church. There are actually some pastors that are worried that people are going, hey, I can stay home and I can worship and I can get to the message online. Why do I need to go to the, and I'm using the air quotes in front of you here, the big box churches? And I can get away from now the, what they call the big box, commercialized, entertainment-driven, stereotypical megachurch model and go back to the home church-based model where it's much more intimate. You get to know people. You can minister to people in the gifts of the Holy Spirit. You can have at-home Bible studies. It's very flexible. In fact, one guy, Scott Lively, said in an article on worldnetdaily.com, WND.com, he said that this might actually be training opened up by God to prepare us for that which is to come.
Oh, I think that's so exciting. Actually, and I do believe home groups will meet more frequently and they will become more of the norm or the new normal. Very good.
Well,
very
that
good.
Leads me kind of into the study I want us to talk about, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we may have to do this over a couple of Fridays, but I'm going to give you something to think about today and we'll discuss it. Make sure you have your Bible handy.
Oh, it's right here.
Okay, good. I've got mine too. I want to talk about eschatology.
Well, that's a pretty doggone big word there, Mr. Truth Barista. You're going to have to tell us what eschatology is.
Okay, eschatology. Ology is the study of something. Esca is short for eschaton, which means end times or last things. So eschatology is the study of end times or the last thing. Now, when you start bringing up prophecy to a lot of people, and sad to say, to some pastors, I hate to say this, and teachers, evangelists, etc., they have a tendency to, you know, oh, I don't want to talk about that. Why not? Well, part of the problem is they don't understand it.
Well, that is very true. And I've heard, Truth Barista, from my pastor, he said, well, because there's so many views on it, it confuses people, as well as, and I thought this was very telling, it frightens people.
Yep, and you don't want to frighten people people then begin to react, and that could affect budgets.
No.
Yes. Okay, I'm being a little bit, you know, hard there, but that's part of the concern I've heard as well, is we don't want to chase people away. We want to draw them, you know?
Well, when you read some of the prophecy is very truthful, and it is a little bit, I don't want to use the word scary, but it's not the niceties that we often hear in church. It has a negative side to it.
Well, they want to hear about gentle Jesus. You know, they want to see the good shepherd that's here to take care of his sheep and to hold them close to his breast and to comfort them. Let the little children come to me, kind of. You know, and I'm having a little fun with that, and I'm not downplaying that.
Right.
But you have to realize in the book of Revelation, the Lamb is also a lion of the tribe of Judah. And when Jesus returns, it says he will slay his enemies. And in fact, the robe dipped in blood that is talked about in the book of Revelation that he's wearing when he comes back is the same outfit described of God in the book of Isaiah, where Isaiah says, who is this one coming from Bozrah with his robes dipped in blood? And he goes, they're dipped in blood because I've been trampling my enemies and their blood splashed my clothes. I'm going, that's not the gentle little Jesus I learned about in Sunday school or hear from a lot of pulpits today.
Well, that's true. And yet the Bible does teach that God is a warrior.
He is.
And we see that not only in the Old Testament, but we certainly pick up that narrative in the book of Revelation. He's a warrior.
And because it's in the Bible, it's important. So we have to put both of those things together.
Right.
Now, the other thing I've learned about, and I'm glad you mentioned this, when we talked about eschatology and the fear of getting into the study of last things because it's A, confusing, and because it's confusing, it's resulted in so many different viewpoints. And let's face it, unless God opens up his word can become confusing. In fact, I can recall being a kid growing up reading the Bible. I didn't do much of it because it was confusing. I had no frame of reference. It didn't make sense to me. But when I became a junior in high school, I gave my heart to the Lord. I said, Lord, I want to come come to you. I want to pledge my allegiance to you. Jesus, you're my Lord and Savior. From that moment on, it's just like the Holy Spirit turned a switch on in my head, and I started reading the Bible, and things started jumping off the page to me, which is the ministry of the Holy Spirit igniting the Father's Word and applying it to our hearts in such a way that it strengthens our relationship with Jesus. And so this ignition of the Word is what's needed. Now, the reason I said that is when you read the book of Daniel, and that's kind of where I want to start with this, it's really clear in Daniel chapter 12. This is a man who was taken to Babylon as probably a teenager.
Mm-hmm.
And in Babylon, he was trained in all of the arts and the language of Babylon and the culture of Babylon, but he maintained a distinct identity as a Jehovah worshiping Jew or Israelite of Judah. Okay, well, in the book of Daniel chapter 12, this man who is now about 80 years old, he moves in profound revelations from God. God reveals incredible things to him regarding the march of empires across time. In fact, Daniel sees from his day, the near future, all the way to the end. And even he has questions. In Daniel chapter 12, the one speaking to him on this revelation says, Daniel, seal up this book because it will remain sealed. In other words, not understandable or not fully understandable until the end. I looked at that and I said, that means we can take our best guess. Yes, until the time comes when we need to know. So in a sense, we're on a need-to-know basis. So my then conclusion is we will understand the end time scriptures better the closer we get to the end. And once we've moved into the end, those scriptures will pop open and we'll go, aha, that's what this means.
I have an aha. Because that same verse that you just quoted, seal up these words until, you know, the end of time, it says in the very next part of that sentence, and many will go back and forth. Other versions will say, you know, travel will increase and knowledge will increase. Well, boy, that is today, right? I mean, with the internet, holy schmoly, do we have education and knowledge and all of that. And travel, of course, look at where people go today. They go everywhere.
Right. Now, we can go through, and I don't want to do a complete in-depth study of eschatology, but what has captured my mind, and you brought it up, there are signs of where we're at in history. In fact, the Bible says these are signs that you'll see during these time periods. It also says there are markers, specific things that we should look for as we're going through history that indicate where we're at in God's timeline. Because God's process is he created mankind to be with him in the Garden of Eden and to extend the boundaries of Eden until all of earth is Edenized. However, mankind fell, threw off God's rule and reign, basically traded it for Satan to rule over them. Mankind still exercises this ruling process, which has created kingdoms, empires, nations, and states. But there's coming a time when God says, enough, this human dominion on earth is going to end apart from me. I will become the king once again, and we'll go back to the way it was in Eden, with God in control of everything, and humanity ruling over all earth, and earth will be Edenized. That's the big picture.
I love the big picture.
But
and I
thinking of a big picture,
yes.
Can I get a big picture, or more than a picture of a cup of coffee, because I'm a little empty here.
I'll go grab it.
The sky is falling! The sky is falling!
What's cooking?
They think the sky is falling. This is our chance to scare them out.
Do you think end of the world is near?
All that is going on in the world today, are we living in the end times? Are these the last days? Is the world coming to an end? What does the Bible have to say about this?
Truth Barista, you know, we're living in such turbulent times with this coronavirus. What advice would you have for our audience?
Well, the first thing, you have to not give into fear, right? I mean, you listened to a recent Dennis Prager.
Yes, and he was saying some wonderful things. Don't waste this time, but contact your friends by phone or by Skype and talk to them and your family. Do things that you haven't done for years. Do things together as a family in your own home, but do something productive and don't sit and mope and get depressed by what you hear on the news.
So on the negative side, don't give in to fear, right? That means we have to limit our consumption of the news, consumption of social media. Now, we don't want to be uninformed. We want to be informed. But man, talk about Debbie Downers. And stay away from the people who are being uber sensational
right.
about this and just stoking the fires. We don't need this. It is what it is, okay? It's like a pandemic, like a flu-type pandemic, although it has different characteristics. But, and this is the point I'd like to make, too, is admittedly, and apparently, this has a high infection rate. So if we lower the possibility of infection, we'll have a lower potential for spread, and that will lower the severe number of cases and even deaths, and lower the strain on the hospitals so that they can keep pace and give proper care for those who need it. So really, the positive thing is, this is a great opportunity, like you said, to stay at home, stay in the neighborhood. I've seen a lot of people walking their dogs, hanging out with their kids, gardening already, doing some fantastic things. And you know what's the most important thing for us? You gotta stay in the coffee, and you gotta stay in the Word.
What a great combination. Thanks for that encouragement, Truth Barista.
And don't forget to listen to the past episodes of The Truth Barista.
Great thought. Okay, Truth Barista, you gave us before the break the big picture.
Right.
And I get that. So, however, I like to know the difference specifically between a sign and a marker. And you sort of said a little bit about that, but let's really define it so people understand when a sign is a sign, it's this way, and a marker is this way.
Right. This is totally my own construct here. Okay, ready? Okay, imagine in your mind you're taking a road trip out west, right? Off in the distance, you've been through Nebraska, I've been through Nebraska.
And all I can say about that is,
There's only one thing worse than driving through Nebraska during the day. It's driving through Nebraska at night.
Yes.
Because there's nothing except a few... Yeah, anyway, I won't pick on Nebraska too hard. But it's really interesting. Once you get over the border into Colorado, you get to a point where you're looking off in the distance and you start seeing mountains. And they start getting bigger and bigger. And you're going, ah, I must be in Colorado because I see the sign of the mountains approaching. But when I really know I'm in Colorado is when I cross over the border and there is a sign that says, Welcome to Colorado. Okay, the mountains in the distance are the signs. The border sign is the marker. So when you look at eschatology, there are a number of signs that indicate whether we're not in that time period, if we're approaching that time period, or if we're in that time period. But there are definite markers that Daniel and Jesus give us that say, this is where you're at.
Okay, so we have signs and markers, and thank you, Truth Barista, because that made a lot of sense. That illustration was great. Why is all of this important? I mean, does it really matter? God's going to do what he wants to do regardless. Why is this so important for us?
This is really important because we are not just kind of sitting here circling around, you know, our time period, just kind of taking care of the poor and preaching the gospel. And I mean, that's a kind of like a Greek understanding of time. It's circular. The Hebrew understanding of time is more like a bike wheel rolling forward. Yes, we go around the calendar on an annual basis, but as the wheel turns, it's also making a line moving forward. God has a purpose and a plan. It had a starting point, and it has a continuing point, and it has an end point. We need to understand the end point so we can be prepared for the things that God says is going to happen during that transition point between human-led dominion on earth and the kingdom of God dominion on earth.
What you really spoke there, Truth Priest.
I get it. Spoke. Bike tire. Ha, ha, ha. You're good.
Well, thanks. I didn't even know it. I was just going to say, however, that what you spoke there, the optimum word you used is prepared.
That's right. Now, The problem of people not being prepared, it comes actually from two things. Remember I told you about the word eschatology. Now, the problem with people not being prepared, and I get this from Millard Erickson's book, Christian Theology, is you get two reactions. Number one, you get people who are way overexcited about end time studies, and he calls that eschatomania. Okay, that is the intense preoccupation or fixation on end time stuff. Now, fixation is not a good thing unless it's on God. Okay, let's just be clear about that. Now, on the other end of the spectrum, you have eschatophobia, people who are afraid, or it's a fear or an aversion to the study of last things, or at least avoiding discussing it. Now, denial is not good because the end times are coming. We just don't know if we're going to get into it. We don't know if we're in it, or we don't know how long it's going to be. All right? Jesus said, though, the end times are coming, and they are not going to be nice. They're going to be pretty terrible. And the problem is, if we are not prepared for this thing, we run the risk of falling when the storm hits us. Therefore, we need to be aware and prepare for the future while not checking out of the present. And we don't want to check out of the present because we're so preoccupied on the future.
I think Jesus said something very interesting, that these days will become very dark, and even the very elect, God's chosen, will be fooled.
If that were possible, he said.
Well, if it were possible. In other words, the times will become so deceptive and so filled with disillusion that people will actually fall. I mean, I've seen people, and you could say the same thing. There are people that were solid one time in your life that you had relationship with, and then the next thing you know, they're off on some tangent somewhere that's completely different than what the Bible teaches.
And I've known people who have been really solid Christians, and something traumatic has hit their life, and they've jettisoned Jesus. And that's a very sad thing. It grieves me, because I do know, I have two particular people in mind right now, and it's a very sad thing.
It's very sad.
Well, what happens if people have a very, and this is something I need to bring up here, there are a lot of people who have studied eschatology and end time things, and they're very sure of their theology. Mm-hmm. Okay, they're so sure. Well, what happens if it doesn't happen according to their understanding? Remember, Daniel was told to seal up the book. Only in the last days will it become unsealed or understandable. So, in my opinion, when somebody has a very dogmatic theology on these things, if it doesn't go according to their plan, will they fall away from the Lord? Will they say God is a liar? Or will they say my pastor is a liar? And will they turn their back on God?
Well, that's where I think that some pastors just avoid it because they don't want to be accused of saying something that isn't right or eventually proves to be wrong. But I don't think that's a good excuse, personally.
Right, I understand that.
And I think that people should say very clearly, it can have a variety of ways that it will end up. It's just that people will get so caught up in that, it becomes, this is the way it's going to be. Well, God shows us through history that it's not always the way that we think it's going to be.
Right, so we have to be very careful. In fact, when I teach on this particular subject to my home groups and other classes that I teach outside of the coffee shop here, even, you know, the gathering that's back in the booth back there, the encouragement booth, I always say, you know, at this time, this is how I see it. I'm going to hold it lightly. However, I'll let you know when I get there. You see, we'll hold it lightly while we see the signs develop, but when that marker goes by, boom, that's when we can say, this is that witch. In fact, Peter did that.
Okay.
Because the book of Joel talks about the last days, and in the last days, God will pour out his Holy Spirit. This is significant because in Jewish thinking, God's kingdom is God's presence. His kingdom showed up on Mount Sinai, and not long after that, the Holy Spirit was given to some of the leadership within Israel. So the outpouring of the Holy Spirit is linked to the presence of God's kingdom. So in Jesus's day, they are looking for the kingdom of God to come because they believe Jesus is the king of God's kingdom. Jesus ascends to heaven. They're waiting for this event, and all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit is poured out on the day of Pentecost. Well, to many in the church, they go, it's the beginning of the church, or hallelujah, it's speaking in tongues and the gift of the... In the Jewish mind, looking at that, they're going, this is another Mount Sinai. This is God creating, releasing his kingdom on earth in a new way, and it's marked by the presence of the Holy Spirit. This is why Peter stands up in Acts chapter 2, and he says, this is that which Joel said was a marker of the last days, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Now, the difference is not everybody on earth got the Holy Spirit. Joel is talking about everybody getting the Holy Spirit. So was Peter wrong or he's right? It's both. He is right in the sense that the last days are marked with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He is, in a sense, going on the information that he has, it's not the fullness of the kingdom of God. So here's going to adjust some people's theology right away. The last days started 2,000 years ago, and Peter says that's the marker. But we haven't hit the end times of the last days.
Now, I know you're going to tell us about that marker.
Yes.
But let me just rewind just a little bit, just so, because you say so many good things in a breath that I want to go back.
Okay,
so you said there's a marker known as Mount Sinai.
Right.
And what happened there?
At Mount Sinai, this happened 50 days after Israel left Egypt in the Exodus. You'll find this in the book of Exodus. And in chapter 20, they have this little encounter with God. So God delivers the bunch of slaves out of Egypt, and he says, Moses, bring them all to Mount Sinai. So Moses brings them all to Mount Sinai, and God comes down and says, okay, I had a covenant with your fathers. You're all their descendants. I'm their God, your ancestors' God. I will be your God. I will be your king. Will you be my subjects? And Israel said, yeah, we'll do that. And God says, okay, this is the way you have to live. You cool with that? And they said, we will hear and we will obey. Okay, at that point, Israel became the first, in a sense, manifestation of God's kingdom on earth through that nation, because he was their king, they were his people. Now, you move through history, and God says, I'm going to introduce who the one who will be the king of Israel in perpetuity, that is Jesus the Messiah. Now, we're jumping ahead about 1,500 years to Jesus' day, okay? And at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes down. They're on a mountain called Mount Zion, but it's the same type of things. A mighty rushing wind at Pentecost, sound like a blast furnace in Sinai. Tongues of fire on the Temple Mount, tongues of fire, or fire manifesting at Sinai. It's in pictures, a Jewish mind would go, this is the exact same thing. God is creating a new version, or you want to call it Kingdom 2.0 in Messiah, on the day of Pentecost, or what they would call Shavuot. Okay, that is a marker of something significant happening, a change into a new era, so to speak.
Well, that's a little bit like what sociology teaches.
Okay.
Sociology says a sea change is one of those kinds of things that happen in society that we will never go back to the way it was before, i.e., an example would be the computer age. That was
right.
A sea change. Television, sea change.
The industrial age.
Absolutely,
yep.
Sea change. And so what you're saying theologically is these markers are sea changes.
Right, and so from the standpoint of eschatology, or the study of last things, Jesus back in his day said, okay, boys, and we're going to get to this. We'll talk about Daniel first, then we'll talk about the Jesus end times talk on the Mount of Olives. Those two things we'll focus on for a reason. But he says to the boys, okay, this is what's going to happen in the near future. This is what's going to happen in the interim. And this is what's going to happen at the end. Watch for these signs. Watch for these markers. And by the way, Jesus didn't come up with new markers. He actually points back to Daniel and says, Daniel's got the markers right here. I'm just giving you the signs and the process that, and where I fit into that whole process. It is really fascinating. Now, you can spend all of your time looking at the details and what Paul says, what Peter says, what, you know, Hebrew words and all this stuff, but really what I want to touch on is this foundation rock, a benchmark, so to speak. You know what a benchmark is, don't you?
Yeah, it's something that's on a bench.
Yeah, no. Okay, a benchmark is a metal plate or a spike that's driven in at a specific spot in the ground, and everything is measured out from that benchmark. So Daniel and Jesus serve as like twin benchmarks, and then everything regarding eschatology needs to be measured out from those benchmarks. Why? Because Daniel got this massive revelation on how God was going to restore his kingdom to earth. And second, Jesus is God himself. So we don't put Paul's words over Jesus, although we do believe Paul was inspired by the Holy Spirit. We don't put anybody's words over Jesus, even though they may be well-educated or seminary-trained. We go with Jesus's words first. Follow?
Oh, I do, and that, in a way, is a marker as well. So, Truth Barista, we've got to get back to doing some cleansing and cleaning of the coffeehouse, because we're hoping to open soon. So, okay, so what we've talked about today, and we'll pick it up next week, are the markers and the signs. Once again, bring that to a conclusion so we can get back to work.
Okay, we're going to be studying eschatology, the study of end times. We're not going to be overly fixated on it. Neither are we going to shy away from these things. And in order to find out what the Bible has to say about it, specifically Jesus and Daniel, we are going to look at the signs that fit between the markers showing when we've hit the end times, when we're in the end times, and the end of the end times before we move into this new time of God's kingdom on earth. Are you ready to roll? Because this is going to be fascinating.
I can't wait till next week.
This is Jay, your Truth Barista. Thanks for listening to the Truth Barista podcast.